We're just waiting on Amanda, and I can't decide. I've got some individual students logging in, so I'm not sure if she is having them log in or if she is logging in. So we're going to wait just a minute. We have one more coach from Greenland that is on the way. There she is. Okay, I think we will go ahead and get started. Good morning, everyone. My name is Jerry Price. I am the project coordinator for the HIRED program. The HIRED program is a local career coaching program, and many of you that are listening today are participating in one of the things that we're presenting. Coaches, if you do not mind, would you just do a little bit of a sign-in, or you can send me an email later with the names of all of our participants, and we'll get that added into some of our documentation. So the way this is going to roll on a weekly basis is we'll get started, and then each week we're going to hear from a different employer that employs people for driving and CDL in particular. Some of them will do on-the-job training. Some of them won't. Some of them require you to go to school first. We are focusing on being attentive to the ones that will hire you at the age of 18. And so, as you know, in Arkansas, you have to be 18 to get a CDL, but you can't do everything until you turn 21. And so there are limitations, and we'll talk a little bit about those limitations as we go through. But first, I want to introduce to you our speaker for today, and that is going to be Erica Betancourt. Erica is an HR, if I'm not mistaken, HR person for SMG. So I will let her take over and talk about SMG as a company, who they are, what they do, and then what they have to offer young people like yourself as you finish school and or go into the workforce. So, Erica, you are welcome to take over.
Thanks, Jerry. Good morning. As she mentioned, I'm the HR manager for SMG. I also support APAC and Arcola and also Marion County Paving. That's my area. But the focus for you all today is SMG, which is our ready mix, basically department, I guess, of our area. And they are in charge of logistics, you know, sending, receiving orders from contractors or any of our bids that we're awarded. And we have about 61 drivers right now. We have trained a total of, let's see, 63 as well, but some of them are in transition. Like what we do is offer an individual to come in, you know, off the street with no CDL. We do ask, you know, to kind of have some skin in the game, you know, for them to obtain their permit. And if, you know, once they obtain their permit, we get them with our, we're very fortunate. We've just started this program last year, and it's really, you know, produced a wealth of new candidates. And it was just getting difficult, you know, to hire anybody that had their CDL. So we saw the need. We were fortunate to run into Russ Kirkpatrick at some point. You know, hopefully you guys will get to meet him. But he's our very own instructor. So he came on board and got this learning plan together for us. He has his own driving range out there. Once the individual comes in and is interested in the CDL, which we only require a Class B to drive a ready mix truck, then basically they get put in queue to start their training with him. He goes over everything from pre-trip to post-trip, to just everything from driving that truck, you know, safety hazards and anything that you're going to be encountering while out on the road. And like I said, he has his own driving range that we actually set up. You know, land was a piece of property was cleared that it used to be an Arcola plant, and it was inactive, so we decided to utilize it for that, so that space is definitely come in, you know, and really done really great for the company. So when a student comes to him, he puts him through the studying. He's very passionate about his students, so he will let you know if it's working out or if it's not, because it's a really serious, you know, it's a really serious piece of equipment, you know, driving that ready mix truck, and it's different, you know, from just a regular flatbed truck and whatnot, because there's actually material in there, and you know that drum is turning, and there's a lot of safety hazards in place. So he makes sure that the individual is very comfortable, you know, to the point where he gets them set up himself at the driver control, and he goes with them, and they go with the official, and you know, they take their test, and once they pass, then they come to work for us. They then get partnered with an experienced driver trainer. We have four driver trainers right now, and so we kind of have to be mindful that obviously we have to pace ourselves. We can't just put two people with one driver trainer. Obviously, they don't fit in the truck. So, and it's, you know, the focus is to make sure that they feel comfortable enough. And we give them a period of anywhere from 3 to 4 weeks. And if we need to, we can extend that so that the driver feels comfortable to drive on their own. And then they get released as a CDL ready mix driver. Now, some of the perks with that is, you know, if the person doesn't have their CDL, they don't even have a permit, they can come in to work as a concrete laborer. And they help them there at the concrete plant, which is a very good thing, because it's somewhat like an internship. They teach them what happens in the plant, what happens in dispatch, what happens with the batchmen. And so they learn, you know, all the things that are connected to the driver, because first dispatch has to get an order, then dispatch has to, you know, relay it to the batchman, and then the batchman has to assign it to a driver, and then the driver, you know, takes it to deliver. So there's a lot involved, scheduling, there's a lot of hours that you work. So it just depends on what you're looking for as a career. You know, if you're looking for 8 to 5, obviously it's probably not going to be your wheelhouse. And I don't want to discourage anybody, but we definitely want somebody to come in, you know, understanding that it is a driving position. And that's what we're looking for, you know, somebody who's interested in and being passionate and enjoying what they do and also being safe at the same time. The wages are pretty competitive. You know, we do pay the individual as a concrete laborer at a lower scale. While they're doing their studying and training, they're receiving that pay per hour. And then once they get released on their own, their pay increases to a driver rate. From that point on, after 90 days, as long as performance is, you know, well, they get another merit increase at 90 days. And then if the individual, you know, is still interested in a little bit more pay, they can take the NRMCA certification, which all of that, if you do it, you know, within the first 6 months, it's fresh in your mind because Russ drilled it into you so that you could pass your test, and you're awarded another incentive at that point, you know, per hour. So you can be, and I'll just go ahead and, you know, we start at 19, it goes to 22. And then if you get that NRMCA, it's another dollar. So you can be at 23 in almost, you know, 6 months. So, and again, it just depends on the training period when you become the driver, when you're at the driver rate. Our benefits are, you know, next to all the competitors in the area, that is really what sells a lot of the individuals that come to work for us, because We offer profit sharing. Our match with 401k is 5%. And if you don't know what profit sharing is, it's basically a retirement bonus. So it goes into that same 401k plan that is devised for you after you've been here 90 days. And so you work a whole year and through the end of the December month, and the next year you qualify for your profit sharing, which it could be anywhere from 2 to 6%. I have seen it at 8%. And that's, for me, that's big, you know, because it's money that's going into your retirement. And so that's a perk to me. We do offer, you know, holiday pay. We observe 8 holidays, and we have a, you know, an extra, you know, floating holiday that you can choose. That's a little bit about the program. We do ask, you know, individuals to sign a 2-year agreement. So when you do become a driver, because it does obviously cost, you know, the company some money to get you onboarded. We have them sign a 2-year commitment agreement that you will stay and work for us for a minimum of 2 years. And we can talk about all that, you know, during onboarding and situations like that. But the onboarding does take a little bit just because we do background checks, we do the drug screen. Of course, you have to also do your interview. That's, you know, the main thing. Once we have these results, and you'll come in for orientation, and it's about an hour and a half for orientation. And then once you're done here, then we get you with the driver supervisor, and you get a snippet of what Russ Kirkpatrick goes over with you on the range and in his classroom setting. So that's pretty much it in a nutshell. It is very, it's a very, I'm very, very proud to say that, you know, it's been very good to have that. And as well, I was mentioning to Jerry before you guys joined that NWAC is also partnered with us because they saw the need for a range. They were unable to get grants awarded to have a range of their own, and they didn't have very many employers committed. And this is what I last remember, so I may be off base, so please don't quote me on that. But, you know, they have a simulator on site, and so their students use it, and our students have access to it. It's an amazing simulator. It kind of shows you real life events, you know, that you can encounter, you know, from rainy weather to snow to a flat tire. You can feel everything. So it's really neat that we're able to utilize that. We just signed an agreement, you know, for liability issues to be able to utilize it and for it to be on our property. And so that's really exciting. NWTI obviously is who we first partnered with because they also were getting more and more individuals asking about that program. They always got confused because they're, I think Mid-America Trucking kind of sat off to the east of their building. And so they thought it was connected. And so they would always go and ask about it. And NWTI saw the need after Dr. Rollins joined their school board. He put in for that grant and got the class going. So we started there and partnered with them, and they would go through their class, and they had a small range there, but it was very hard because they only had one instructor, and they couldn't keep up with the influx of candidates that were coming through. So that's where we kind of stepped in and, you know, got lucky, and Russ ended up with us, and we have two instructors now, Russ and Steven, and they're both wonderful guys. Both of them are passionate in different aspects of the program, so they balance each other out, and they definitely want everybody to be successful. So with that said, I'll open it up for questions if you guys have any for me.
I'll start the question and answer, but each of the participants, be thinking of any questions you have for Erica, and I'll open the floor in just a second. So my first question is, Where does the workday start as a general rule? What are the locations that SMG has around Northwest Arkansas as far as like, okay, I could work at from this plant or this plant, that kind of thing?
Right, yeah. So all the work is local here in Northwest Arkansas. So that's another perk, is that you're home every night. You're not over the road, long distance driving, anything like that. Typically, what we like to do is assign the individual to the plant that is closest to their home. However, they can haul out of there or any of the other plants that we have in the area. But ultimately, they end up back at the home plant closest to their home. We have locations in Rogers, Fayetteville. Our main plant is in Springdale. We have one in Huntsville, Gravette. I think I've got all of them. So we definitely can service all of Northwest Arkansas. So that's a good question. I'm sorry I didn't cover that in
Good.
my intro.
Yeah, and then you talked a little bit more about the 2-year commitment. I want to make sure that the kids understand that that's a pretty typical thing for places that pay for your education. And so it's not, I want everybody to know, it's more commentary probably on my part than question, that whenever you hire on to a company that does on-the-job training and they commit to a training that typically is pretty expensive, that's generally a requirement that you sign on to work with them for a period of time, and 2 years is super common. So, Erica, do you have anything more about that part of it?
Yeah, let me see if I can open one of them. Let's see.
We can do more detail later. I mostly just wanted to comment that that's super common, so that the kids that are watching know that's a thing that a lot of people do. It's not just you, it's pretty normal.
Yeah, so they will this driver agreement basically is, so with the onboarding and the training and equipment and everything, it costs us a little under $5,000 to onboard somebody. And so that's not including the time that we spend in the training with the individual, the material that's used to train them with, and then or the equipment, and then the time spent getting them to the driver control to get their license. So we do ask that they commit at least 2 years of service to us. Otherwise, we do require that they pay back a portion, if not the amount of the cost.
Okay. I have a couple more, but let's see if any of the kids have any questions. So
Sure.
the floor is open if any of the students have any questions for Erica.
Don't be shy.
While they're thinking of it and getting up there, like, okay, ask her this. Talk to us about the importance of keeping a clean driving record in working as a driver for SMG.
It's very important to keep a clean driving record because not only when you come in for your onboarding do you fill out all the necessary paperwork to create your file, but we use a third party, which is Kilmar, to keep track of our DOT files for any auditing purposes. And Kilmar is very, very, the reason we use them is because they're very, very detailed. And so they run a driver record to make sure that you're in compliance under DOT, whether that is, if you have any excessive speeding tickets, any suspensions, revocations, anything, that's not going to allow you to drive a DOT required certified vehicle. So it's really important, even if you're off the clock, driving your own vehicle, employees are supposed to report those to us because if you get pulled over in your ready mix vehicle and something pops up and you didn't report it, that jeopardizes your career, because it's your responsibility to report that. But they do, also the employees now, And I think this started January of the year before last year, where the clearinghouse, which is through the Federal Motor Carrier Safety Association, FMCSA, now every driver has to register once they obtain their CDL. And that is how employers are able to keep track of individuals who may potentially have tested positive for drugs or alcohol, whether it's on a pre-screening or during employment, and that would disqualify an individual. And everyone that onboards here with us goes through the drug screening, the breath alcohol testing, and then they have to check in the clearinghouse. And until we receive a clear from them, we can't put them to work anyway. So once everything is passed them, then we put them out to work. So it can be very, very detrimental to the job and the candidate to maintain their job. The other thing, of course, is accidents. And this one's a little bit, tricky, but we do obviously have to do a commercial driver's license physical. And so we use a clinic here locally that we've been doing business with them for years. And so you have to, receive the 2-year certification, or if it's lesser than that, they let us know why. So, health issues, we will hire anybody that meets the criteria, that is cleared by the physician, that meets the DOT standards. So it's important that if you do have any kind of health conditions that, you have to maintain, because they can affect, how much time the doctor authorizes or signs off that you're able to work. So otherwise, if he says, he's got 2 years or 6 months or a year, then, they do work that time, and we keep them closely monitored, because again, we don't want, for one, we don't want to jeopardize your license, and neither do you as a driver. And also, of course, the liability with the company if something should happen and you weren't in compliance because, you didn't report that your 6 months is up, or your month, or your year. But we have our safety department that tracks that anyway. So those are other, factors that can, jeopardize employment. So
real quick on that, DOT physical, is a drug screening a part of the DOT physical, or is that a separate, you guys do a drug screening to employ someone at SMG, but does the DOT physical also have a drug screening with it?
So the clinic will do everything for us. So when we make an appointment for a DOT driver, they will do the physical, drug screen, and breath alcohol the day of. We try to schedule it all in one day so that they don't have to be going back and forth. They're just trying to get to work. We're not, and sometimes they don't have the money to be going back and forth because they're trying to get a job. So we secure the appointment for the very same day, and they'll do the physical, drug screen, breath alcohol, audio, vision. I mean, it's a whole physical.
Yeah, I was wondering, because to get the written exam, they have to have the DOT physical first. And so if they weren't coming to you for everything, would they have to go get that just separately? And I just wondered if the DOT physical had a drug screening. Everybody that hires for drivers is going to do a drug screen, correct?
Yes. And we will. And the good thing about that is that once you are selected and we've made an offer and you've accepted, or the individual's accepted, then we pay for that. So it's not something that you have to repay for. So we pay for the physical, the drug screen, the breath alcohol, everything that comes with it.
Real quick on that, I just want clarity for all of our students so they know, these are the rules we play by. That drug screening includes everything. It includes marijuana. It includes pain medicine, I'm assuming. It would include, of course, the harder illicit drugs, but marijuana and pain medicine are all included, yes?
Yes, it's a 10 panel, so they test everything from opiates, barbiturates, you name it. It'll test for everything. And you know, if somebody does test positive, you know, obviously we would rescind the offer, and that individual, you know, would not be eligible to apply with us for a year from the date of the positive screen. And also, another thing to remember, if they have their, if it's just their permit, then that, I believe, will still go into clearinghouse, which at that point, and I don't know a whole of a lot of this just yet, but we've had one that we did offer and extend employment, and it worked out until it didn't. But he had actually gone through a SAT program, which is a substance abuse. I don't know what the P stands for, but program. And so they have to do that, comply with it, finish it, get a certificate, and then they have to do a whole thing with the FMCSA, probably upload it or notify someone, so that it can show that that individual has, you know, gone through a program, you know, and is now cleared to drive again. But that is something that, you know, the driver has to do on their own. So it's better to not do drugs.
Yeah. Okay. All right. Well, back to questions. Has anybody thought of any questions they would like to ask? We'll open the floor again.
One more thing before we have a question. Hopefully somebody will have one. On that, you know, you mentioned medications. And we understand, like I said, you know, some people have health issues that they have to be on medications and whatnot. If that comes back, you know, that it's a medication that is requires, oh, I don't know, that maybe it can alter your senses or whatnot. When that happens, the medical review officer, which is the individual who reviews the specimen, the urine specimen, and says, oh, you know, it looks like they have, you know, codeine or something. And they contact the individual directly, and they have those questions for the individual. Like that, I wouldn't even be able to tell you what they ask them, but if the individual can provide the prescription medication for it and it falls within DOT regulations, then, you know, we proceed. Otherwise, you know, we wouldn't.
So that just helps the students know what are the right questions to ask if they have some sort of health issue where they have to be on medication, or if they've had a recent injury and they're on pain medicine for a period of time until that heals, they need to know to ask those questions ahead of time and make sure that they fall within the DOT regulations.
Fair? Yes.
Okay.
Yes.
Okay. Any other questions? We have a quiet group today, Erica. I'll tell you
That's
what,
okay.
as you have discussion, and if questions come up, just jot those into an email. If you look at the most recent email I sent you, it has Erica and all the coaches on that email. And so you can just send that back to everybody, and Erica can answer those back to us. And we can do it that way if there are questions as we, because you're going to go into some discussion time in a few minutes. And if you have questions that do come up, then feel free to email and we'll just go from there. How's that sound?
That sounds perfect.
We hope to have Erica back on later in the month with a couple of people from SMG. They're really one of the great opportunities locally to go to work straight out of high school and to have this opportunity to have your education paid for, and or just this on-the-job training in the actual trucks that you would be driving. And so I really like what they offer. So we're going to try to bring her back on with some of her driver and or driver trainer later in the month. So she and I are working on that. All right, Erica, thank you so much. We appreciate you. And we'll let you log off. And hopefully we'll see you again soon.
Sounds good. Looking forward to connecting again. Thank you, everybody. And good luck.
Bye-bye.
Bye.
Okay, so let me fix my screen real quick so that you guys can see me. All right, so again, Jerry Price here. A couple of things that I pulled away from what Erica said, and I think that is not necessarily intuitive to you. as a student going into the space of driving is the whole drug screening thing. You know, it makes a lot of sense that you would never, ever drive a truck or any vehicle while under the influence of, say, marijuana. But it's not necessarily intuitive to know that they're actually screening for that. So you can't do it at all, leading into your physical for being hired. And so I thought that was something that I hadn't really thought of before, but does make a lot of sense. That is a true case. And drug screening, if you want to go to work at McKee, or there are lots of places that any kind of employment as you leave high school, they're going to do a drug screen anyway. So it's not just this driving space. It's really about everywhere. So I know that you guys are aware of things like drug screens, but I thought that was an important thing to bring out. The other thing I want to talk about real quick is when you become a driver and then you get that additional certification within 6 months, you're $23 an hour. If we're talking about truck drivers as a whole, that's not a lot of money. But what we have to remember is that when you graduate, I challenge every single student that they spend the next 4 years in their education. Now, a lot of your peers, they'll go to college and that is their education, and they spend 4 years doing that. Some of your peers will become apprentices and become electricians, plumbers, HVAC, diesel mechanics, and they'll spend 4 years in that apprenticeship. The thing that is different about, let's say, apprenticeship and, say, SMG driving is that they pay you while you get an education. So my daughter is one that's going to college. I went to college. Your coaches all went to college. They paid a lot of money to do that. This education is one that pays you while you're getting the education. So while driving in and of itself is a really lucrative payoff later, if you go over the road, especially, or you drive for Walmart, I think Walmart starts at $90,000 a year, which is a great living. It's more money than I make. It's more money than your coaches make. It's good money. But you have to be 21 in order to do over the road truck driving. And then a place like Walmart, you have to be even older and have 3 years of experience driving. And so there are things that, you know, you have to do to get there. We're not going to leave this program. You're not going to leave this program and go make $90,000 a year unless you work a bunch of overtime, which doable, but you would have to work a tremendous amount of overtime to get there, or two jobs. But you have to think about it as an education process. This is your time to learn, grow, get experience, and develop. So that two-year commitment to a company that will train you, that will make sure you stay at it, busy, lots of work, especially in Northwest Arkansas right now. You're not going to be off unless it is pouring down rain. You're going to be able to make a good living doing that. And $23 an hour, Western Mitten County, Lincoln area, that's not bad money, not to start with. You know, if there are some jobs that start higher than that, but typically they require some sort of education. And so $23 an hour with no education, no, I didn't go to college or trade school or tech school. I just went to work for SMG and then they trained me. That's pretty good money. So that's just kind of what you want to think about. We're going to hear from Coca-Cola next week, and they hire 18-year-olds that just finished their CDL, and we'll see what they say on their starting wage. And so we can kind of compare. So that's kind of where we're at there. So what I want to do now, does anybody have any questions before we move on? Or coaches, do you guys have any questions before we move on? We got about 25 more minutes, maybe a little longer. And so we're going to go into a little bit of things that I want to share with you. One of the things I want you to know is that really what this program is about is equipping you to get through the written exam. So just like your regular driver's license, you have to take a written exam before you take your driving exam as a CDL to get your CDL. And so this is about the written exam. We also have the opportunity to get you into school at NWTI, and I think that will be at no cost to you as long as you are hired on as a CDL driver or as like a diesel mechanic that requires a CDL. And so we have that option as well. In that case, we put you through school, we get you signed up, and we're working on that in the background. You get signed up, you go to school for 4 weeks, 2 weeks for a Class B CDL, 4 weeks for a Class A CDL, and then you get your job, and then there is a grant that repays that debt. You don't have to pay for it up front, though. So we're working on that. That works for lots of careers, not just driving. But if you know, I want to be a driver, it may be faster for you to go to work for SMG. You definitely would be making money much sooner to go to work at SMG than it would be to go to the CDL program at NWTI, then working on getting a job, and so forth and so on. So if you know you want to drive, this is a great way to get started, to be making money on the front end right away, rather than having to wait and go through school separately from being paid. They pay you while you're learning to drive. So this is a really good option. Okay, next we're going to talk a little bit. I'm going to share my screen, and I want to go through a couple of things. And in equipping you to get through your test, I'm going to show you some resources that I've come up with. Hold on. Let me get some stuff out of the way here. Okay. So your coaches have access to this document, this commercial driver's license prep classes. Talks a little bit at the top. They can send this to you in an email, and then these links will be live for you, along with the fact that you are welcome to log into the Zoom yourself. Your coach does not have to do that. I like it when you're together with the coach, and the reason is because we're going to cut you guys loose to do some investigating and some studying, and you can talk to each other if you're all in the same room. So I do suggest that you come to the meetings. Right here are the dates, and it is just every Thursday in February at 9 a.m. I've got us scheduled until 10:15, but usually that last 15 minutes will be you guys studying and working together at your place. So you'll be actually getting on the app and doing some practice questions or watching a YouTube video together and talking about it. So really our session will be till about 10. And then the next 15, if you guys want to stay on for 30 minutes and the coaches have clearance for that, then you can stay on. What our primary goal in this is to create a time and a space for you to engage with studying for the exam, helping you get to that place where you can pass it with confidence. And so that you also know the exact steps that you need to take. So for us, we will help you get ready for the exam. We'll help you find the place to get your DOT physical, which you do have to take before you can take the written exam. And so let's just kind of walk through. We kind of talked about this last time, but real quick, let's walk through your steps. First of all, before you sign up for your DOT physical, you have to get your packet. And when I say packet, that means you go to the revenue office, a state revenue office, and you buy a packet for $50. If $50 is more than you can afford because of whatever circumstances are going on in your life or your parents' life, or if you live with extended family, whatever that case may be, we do have a scholarship for that. For that $50, you can talk to your coach about that. And so that is an option that you have. You have to sign up for the packet, and they sign you in, they assign it to you. It has a number on it, and you need that number off of the packet when you sign up to go take your written exam. You need that number when you go take your DOT physical, because they'll give you that, they'll put it on the physical paperwork. And so that's kind of the order of things. So get your packet, DOT physical, and then written exam. So our goal would be that sometime in March, but March 1st is the date that I put here to get registered for the NWTI CDL course, if that's the direction you want to go. If not, then what we want to do is we want to start helping you apply for jobs at places that will train you and do like the SMG job. We want to start that process in March, so that when you graduate, you will hit the ground running and you're ready to go. And so there is a portion, let's say that you went to NWTI, there is a 15-hour online portion of that training. And we want to, if we can get you signed up in early March, we will create some other time set aside for you to work through that 15-hour online part of that training. And then about April, we are hopeful, this is not set in stone, to be able to participate in some bus driving training. But we're still working on that, and that may not work out at all. There is a rule about being 19. I'm hopeful to do some of that training in advance of going to NWTI just for experience. So we'll come back to that. And then this summer, you would be taking the courses. These are the dates of the NWTI school. Now, NWTI is not the only truck driving school in Northwest Arkansas, it's just the easiest for us to work with. It is the least expensive in the state of Arkansas. So that is true on that part. However, we do have the grant right now that will be paying for that. Okay, so qualifying students, one thing I did not put in here, and I'm going to add that in, is you have to be able to pass a drug test. And again, if I can spell, that includes everything from marijuana to illicit drugs, pain medicines, if, like we talked about, if you had an injury or something like that. The other thing is you need to either be a US citizen and have a copy, an official copy of your birth certificate, or a US passport or a certificate of naturalization. So if you're not, if you were not born in the United States, then you have to be either naturalized or have your ability to work in the United States. Okay, so let's go on. I want to show you a couple of things. First off, I want you to look at this app. So everybody pull out your phones. And we're going to download a CDL test prep app. This is the one that was recommended to me from a trainer that trains for CDL. So if you notice, look right here, see this icon? This icon is a steering wheel, and it's got the crossbar in the middle and then going down. This looks like this on my Android app store. That's what it looks like. It may look slightly different on an Apple device, so I don't know for sure, but notice that the person that created this one was Jeffrey Diaz. Now, this is not to say that this is the only one or the best one ever. This is just the one that was recommended to me. And I think you'll find that it is helpful. So everybody look at that and then kind of talk to me. Somebody get that has an Apple phone. Tell me if you find that exact icon or if they've changed that icon to something else. Talk to me and let me know.
Jerry, this is Sarah Lincoln. It looks like they found it and it looks like yours, but the background is blue
Okay.
in the search.
Perfect. So we have a blue background, but with that same symbol on it. So everybody, I want you to go ahead and download that app. Let me know, coaches, whenever you're kind of there and you feel like, yeah, we're there.
Jerry, my kids are asking, is it practice mode? Are we getting
Okay,
ahead
yeah,
of you?
so that's what we're going next. Yeah, so it sounds like
Okay.
you guys are pretty much there. So you're going to see when you pull that up, you have practice mode and you have exam mode. So practice mode is where I think everybody should start. The other thing I want you to notice is at the very top, there's something you should see, general knowledge. Click that drop down. Those, the things that you read there are all the subtests that are on the CDL exam. Okay, and so everybody has to take general knowledge and air brakes. And Melissa, coach, do you remember the third test that everybody has to take?
They have to do air brakes. They have to do, oh my gosh, what is that third one?
That's okay. There's a third one I'll
I'm
have.
sorry, I don't remember.
Yeah, I'll have
I'm
that
sorry.
information before you for our next meeting next week. But everybody for sure has to take general knowledge and air brakes. So there's not any point today or in the next maybe two sessions to work on anything else other than working through general knowledge and air brakes. And so let's just click general knowledge and let's click, let's go over to the right-hand side of the top on mine and look at manuals. And notice all the states are there. I've already chosen Arkansas on mine, but you'll need to choose Arkansas in that. And then you can open that manual. You will also get a copy, a physical copy of the manual when you buy your packet. So when you buy that packet, it comes with a paper. It assigns your number to you, your DOT number to you. And then it also has an Arkansas driving manual for CDL in it. So just real quick, open the manual. If you click open, you don't have to go all the way through, but it's a download and it'll just download it onto your phone, your computer, whatever you're using. I'm not going to download it right now and I don't suggest you do either for the moment. And so going back to where we were at, I have to back out. So we're going to go Arkansas manual. Just make sure you have that selected and then practice mode. And notice it pretty much jumps into questions. It's really just test questions. I think it's always good rather than, I don't know if you guys are wired the way I'm wired, but the way I'm wired, what I would do, and I'm actually going to show you one more thing on this. So I'm going to leave, I'll come back and I'll share my, keep my screen shared for just a second. The way I'm wired, I want to look at some of the questions first before I go reading a manual. And I kind of suggest that for all test prep. I suggest that for ACT. For ACT, I suggest that you look at questions before you go reading and doing like other kinds of practice to see, get an idea of what the test is like. It was also suggested to me that once you use this app and you go into test mode, when you can pass those tests at a 90% three times in a row without, you know, backing down to a 70 or an 80%, you will pretty much be ready for this exam. And so I assume that many of you passed your written exam for your car or your pickup by doing that exact thing. Now, I am also going to encourage that we're going to spend some time going through a manual and looking at it and, you know, kind of really kind of digging into what you need to read and look at. But I think the app is probably going to be your primary prep, you know, option. The other thing that I wanted to look at real quick, and we'll come back to the app. So set that aside for a second. On a computer, you can download this if you need to read before you get your packet. You want to start reading. There's the download of the manual. And then right now, we're going to go to a couple of YouTube places. We're not going to watch the whole video. I'm going to leave that to you to determine if you want to watch that when we get off of here together. You can watch the one that I'm going to show you, or if that's something you want to do on your own. So I'm going to suggest when we get off of here that the coaches sit with you and you guys decide, are we going to look at the app for a while, or are we going to watch one of the videos together? But I'm showing, and this, so obviously your coaches have this document. And I'm showing
you don't need to pay a single penny for a useless doorbell camera subscription. Starting now.
If you're watching this video, then
all right. So this Driving Academy, The Road to Freedom, this guy has a lot of videos that are specific to the three main tests that you have to take. This one is about general knowledge. And so what we want to do, I feel like between now, next week, the next week, we want to make sure that you are getting everything for general knowledge, that you are able to pass that portion of the test. And then you will move on to air brakes and the other one. So we're going to watch just a minute of this, and then we'll turn it. We'll come back. I'll show you the other link of the other YouTube channel that I
That means that you're looking for CDL general knowledge questions and answers. And that's what we're going to be giving you today. My name is Jonathan, and I'm the founder of Driving Academy, the best truck driving school in the entire country.
Hey, coaches, is the sound okay? The volume's okay on your end? Okay, good.
And in this video, we're actually going to be giving you true questions and true answers that are going to show up on any general knowledge test that you're going to take, no matter what part of the country that you're in. We help thousands of students every single year get their CDL license by getting them past all the written exams, plus get them past that 2.5-hour long road test. Now, this video is going to be a little bit different than those other videos out there because I'm not a robot and I'm an actual person. So let's get into the questions and answers that you're going to need to know in order to pass your general knowledge test.
Okay, so what he talked about there, there were lots. I've done a lot of research on the YouTube options, and a lot of them use a robot reads it. And so that's what he's referring to. And it does get a little bit like, you know, boring. I like a person. He also goes through and talks about you'll see he'll do a question and then he'll give the rationale behind it. And so let's listen to just a couple of questions that he goes through, and then we'll go back to
that being said. What I'm going to do is I'm not just going to give you questions and answers and hopefully that you memorize it. I'm going to give you some knowledge behind why the answer is what it is. So even if DMV goes in there and switches one of the questions or one of the words in that question, you're still able to pass this test with no problems, right? The problem when people have taking this general knowledge test is they go in memorizing just specific questions, which means specific answers are tied to that. But the problem is DMV can switch one word and everything's different. So it's time to actually teach you the proper way to think about this stuff, give you the real knowledge. And this is going to be a sample of what you'd get if you become an actual student here at Driving Academy. And like I said, we're the best in the country. So let's give you the best answers and questions for the CDL general knowledge exam. So let's go one more time. The first question that we're going to be talking about in the CDL general knowledge is going to be this question here. When traveling down a downgrade, you should do what? A. Shift gears when necessary. B. Never shift gears. C. Use engine retarders only if necessary. Or D. A and C. Well, a lot of people are probably going to pick D, but the real answer here is going to be never shift gears. So when you're actually traveling down a downgrade, that means your whole vehicle is actually going downhill, right? And if you're in a manual transmission vehicle, the way it should work is as you're traveling uphill, you want to make sure that you're in the proper safe speed. So say you're traveling uphill in about eighth gear. The rules are by the time you go downhill, you want to make sure that you go to one gear lower than the gear you climbed up, which means that you're going to be in seventh gear on the way down. This is going to prevent any kind of downgrading or any kind of shifting necessary because you're going to be at a safe speed and your engine is going to keep you at that speed and you don't have to wear out your brakes. If you do this correctly, then you're going to avoid a lot of mistakes and a potential big fine and a big accident itself. So the answer to this question is B, never shift your gears when going down a long downgrade, because all you have to do is mess up one time and not get into gear. All of a sudden, now you're traveling in neutral and good luck trying to stop an 80,000 pound vehicle going down a downgrade that can take miles and miles on end, right? That's something called a Mexican overdrive. I don't know how it got the name, but pretty much that's where you're just pretty much just going and you're gonna put your head between your legs and you're gonna kiss you know what goodbye, because it's very little and very hard for you to control. So the question here is going to be B, never shift gears. All right.
Okay. So I'm going to step out of that. What I liked about what this guy did and what I want you to watch for as you get other YouTube resources to help you get through this exam is, number one, it wasn't just the question and the answer. It was the question, the answer, and all of the rationale behind the answer. I think you guys probably learned a lot just from his explanation. So whether it's this guy or other YouTube videos, be sure that they are explaining why things are the way they are. I would never have understood never shift gears. Well, if you slip out and can't get back in, you're free fall. So, you know, those are kinds of things I want you to be aware of. So the other one, I'm gonna go back real quick. Let me get this out of the way. I'm gonna show you another one that I thought was a good resource.
I went to bed with a younger man because of my husband's ED. This simple mix of ingredients is
capable of making... Okay, that was awesome. Like, I can't even plan this way. So this is another one that I thought was pretty good, but we'll just compare and contrast. I'll just compare and contrast this one with the other video.
Welcome to DMV Path, CDL Prep Test. General Knowledge Part 1, 61 questions and answers to study for your CDL permit test. I'll be reading every question and you have 10 seconds to figure out the correct answer before it is revealed to you. Some questions may be duplicated just to help you review and effortlessly memorize the answers. Good luck. Question.
Okay, so you can already tell it's a computer reading it. This is for a different purpose. If you use one of these types, it's because you want to be in test mode. You're trying to check yourself on, do I know it well enough to go through quickly? But if you prefer to hear it and see it on and use YouTube with it rather than the app, this is a little bit further down the road because it's not going to give you the rationale. But let's listen to a couple of these.
Number one, you are driving a 40-foot vehicle at 35 miles per hour. The road is dry and visibility is good. What is the least amount of space you should keep in front of your vehicle to be safe?
So notice how it's test mode, like it's wanting you, and so you're going to say it in your head or jot on a piece of paper or whatever, and then...
The correct answer is B, 4 seconds. Explanation. The formula for following distance is 1 second for each 10 feet of vehicle, plus an additional second if you're traveling over 40 miles per hour. As a result.
So test mode plus explanation, that's good. But it is the computer reading it. So I'm going to slip out of this. You can kind of determine from there where you want to be. All right. So at this point, we're at 10 o'clock. And what I want to do is I want to locally give you some time and some space today. We had it scheduled till 10:15 to determine personally, and then as a small group at Lincoln, at Huntsville, wherever, what you want to do next. Like, you guys can take the videos that I've shown, like the first one is 25 minutes long. And so we did 4 minutes, you got 20 minutes left. You could watch that video right now. You could also do the next one, or you could just spend time on the app looking through the question. And so you can start doing questions on the app. We want you to have some time and some space. If you're somebody that does better with having something read to you, YouTube might be the way to go, at least on the front end. If you're better at, like, I just want quiet reading and going through it, maybe the app is better. This test can also be read to anybody that needs it read to them, just like the regular driver's test. So if you feel like that might be a better fit for you, talk to your coach before we get you ready to do the written test. And let's talk through what that needs to look like and how you need to sign up for that. So right now I'm going to open it to, do you have any questions? Coaches, are there anything that coaches can think of or students have, you know, kind of brought up? Again, you can bring up your questions and we can go email with that. There are two things I want you to think about, coaches. One, we're every Thursday. That doesn't mean you can't run a small group with these students outside of just Thursday. I think they're going to need time and space to study. And if that looks like them coming to your room for 30 minutes, going through questions on the app or watching YouTube videos and going through it, that's fine. I actually am strongly encouraging that, just to keep us going. And so getting kids ready. The more you engage with the material, the better your chances of passing the test. I think you'll be ready whenever it's time to sign up for it, but I want to make sure that you got to study. If you're not going to study, you're not going to pass. So coaches, do you have any questions for me?
I just put in the chat, Jerry, that, because I know they were talking about they only require class B CDL. That's the passenger. So if you get the class B, you have to have the basic knowledge, the air brakes, and the passenger.
Okay.
So I put it in the chat. I didn't know if everybody had seen it or not. And I had a brain freeze there and couldn't think of it, but that's the additional one for class B.
Yep. Okay. And so here's a couple of things too. I just want to mention this. So when you're 18 until you turn 21, It's almost like you are a class B driver to a certain extent. You can't cross state lines. You can't go over the road. Can't go from Oklahoma into Arkansas. And so some people say, well, you might as well just get your class B in the first place. And that may be true. That's all you really need for the most part at 18. And so it's a shorter training period. It's less expensive if you're paying for it. But at the end of the day, that class A just turns into a class A, loses all the restrictions when you turn 21. So the sooner you do that, if that's the long-term goal, then we certainly want you to be like in a course that gets you all the way through the class A. And so we can talk a little bit more about that later. But yeah, any other questions or comments before I jump off and you guys continue at your place? All right, I'm pretty excited. I think this is a great opportunity for our young people to, have a really awesome career. If you're geared for it, if you're wired for it, it's an awesome career to be a driver. There are some other things. If you have your school bus license and you have your CDL, you could also have a great side hustle. You can make pretty good money driving sports teams and coach and some different things like that. So that's also an opportunity that you have. Like, I want to do this main gig, but I also have this side hustle where I drive on the weekends or I drive football teams, on Friday night and make some pretty decent money, extra money. It sure beats Grubhub and DoorDash for sure, on how much you make doing that. So anyway, I will let you guys go. You guys can take over and spend as much time as you need with your coach or what they have allotted, and then we will go from there. And I will see you guys next week at 9 o'clock.